Dr. Monica Serban from the University of Montana. She has a broad and diverse background in materials and their applications for biomedical sciences, including screens for hernias in both industry and in academia. She has worked with silk fibrin and also biomaterials for therapeutics. She joined the University of Montana in 2015, and we're looking forward to hearing about Thixotropic hydrogels for biomedical applications.
Awesome. Thank you, Marissa, for introduction, and thank you for coming. I am very pleased to be here because I have students here that I usually see through a small screen, so it's nice to see them in real size. So as Marissa indicated, I'll talk about two projects that fall under the same umbrella of thixotropic hydrogels for biomaterial applications. And this is an outline of my talk. I thought it might be a good idea to start with the beginning. And I'll go into telling you our story with HAGs. Then I'll let you know how we became all ears. And I'll end up with some fun stuff that we do in our lab. So, the beginning. So as Marissa indicated, I joined the University of Montana in August 2015 after spending close to 5 years in industry. I was in the medical device industry in the product development department. And so you'll see some leftover industry tendencies in my talk. But basically, right around that time, actually, I'll go into that in a little bit. But first, I would like you to meet the Serban lab. So this is our lab currently. It consists of 4 members. I have Bobby, who's a research associate. Christian is a master's student in interdisciplinary sciences. Eric is a material sciences PhD student. And Alex is our very talented undergrad. And so what are we working on is biomaterials, and specifically they're focused on developing drug delivery systems and 3D cell culture systems. And also we have a few projects that are focused on developing new medical devices, such as artificial skin for wound healing and surgical sealants. So, right around the time that when I accepted the job at University of Montana, my former PhD advisor, who's up there, his name is Glenn Presswich, he's at the University of Utah, was getting ready for retirement. So he sent me an email and asked me, hey Monica, I have this cool project on thixogels. Do you want to take it over? I was like, thixo what? I don't really know what the project is about, but I know he has cool stuff going on. I was like, yeah, sure. It's probably going to be a quick paper for me, you know, brownie points for tenure. Let's go for it. So I went down to Salt Lake City. I met up with Glenn and his last students. And that's how we ended up working on thixogels. So obviously, I had to do some due diligence and learn what thixogels are. So thixogels, or thixotropic materials, basically have a stable form at rest, so under static conditions, but become fluid under some kind of stress, typically shear or agitation. And some examples of thixotropic materials are, as Fred indicated earlier, mayonnaise and ketchup, two materials that everybody knows. You know, they're kind of hard to get out of the bottle unless you really shake it and squeeze it, but then it flows out. So that's an example of thixotropic material. Well, a cooler thixotropic material is the T-1000 bad guy from Terminator that can transition between a solid and liquid form. But hey, our materials are not that glamorous. So this is what we have, and this is our thixogel project foundations, is the tetraethyl orthosilicate, which is this molecule here. And I'll refer to it as Teos. So Teos gets hydrolyzed under acid conditions. Is this working? Maybe not. Come on. Come back. It's a mind of its own. Okay, there we go. So tails gets hydrolyzed as a precursor for our hydrogels under acidic conditions, forms this short-lived silicate, and then it polymerizes into this network. And that's the scaffold for our hydrogels, basically. And so how our gels behave, you can see it here. This is an upside-down conical tube, and you can see the gel kind of here maintaining its form. If you vortex it or just shake it, it becomes a liquid and you can pipette it out, as you can see it in this picture. You can pipette it out in a new dish or whatever you want, and it's gonna gel within minutes, and then the cycle can be repeated. So that's an example of a thixotropic behavior. And again, that's the foundation for our materials. So getting into our story with HAGs. So this project is basically around developing dynamically cross-linked, reversible 3D cell culture matrices. And I know that the title has a mouthful of words, but I'll try to explain them as we go through the slides. So 3D cell cultures, why are they important and why are they better or different than 2D cultures? So this image here, which is from a publication that's referenced up here, shows a cartoon of a cell that's distributed three-dimensionally. And so in our bodies, cells are surrounded by the extracellular matrix, which is a mixture of proteoglycans, proteins, and glycosaminoglycans. So cells exist in our bodies in a three-dimensional environment. So basically, cells exist in this kind of configuration here. Now, when you try to get the cells isolated from tissues and grow them in two dimensions or in the regular petri dishes or tissue culture plates, this is how the cell would interact with its scaffold, which in most cases is some kind of plastic that's been treated to provide attachment sites for the cells. So you can kind of guess that this behavior is not really representative of how the cells behave and exist in 3D or in the body. So that's why now I think it's in the past two decades that there's a push to move towards three-dimensional cell cultures and move away from two-dimensional cell cultures. Now, the two-dimensional cell cultures have the advantages of being very user-friendly and pretty straightforward. However, again, there's more and more data coming out showing that, for instance, applications where you're trying to screen drugs for therapeutic applications, the data that you get from 2D cell cultures is very different than the in vivo results and also very different from the 3D cell cultures. And then 3D cell culture data for drug screening is more comparable to in vivo situations. So there's a push towards moving the traditional culturing techniques towards 3D. And so, obviously, when there's a need for something, there's solutions coming out and to address the problem. And I don't know if any of you work with three-dimensional matrices, but there are quite an assortment available currently on the market. I just have up here three pictures. I believe the first one here, I cannot see the letters, the writing, but I think it's Matrigel. Matrigel is extracted from mouse sarcomas. So it's basically mice are induced to grow tumors, and then the tumor extracellular matrix is extracted and then sold as Matrigel. So it contains all the cytokines, proteins, and extracellular matrix components. Now, you can anticipate some issues with that, right? So it's animal derived, first of all. It's coming from a tumor environment. So we all know that tumors do not behave normally. And plus, you have variation from lot to lot. Not all animals are similar, right? So lot A of Matrigel might be slightly different composition-wise than lot B. There's also pure collagen that's available that you can use as a 3D matrix. And then also, there are some combination products that contain different extracellular matrix components. For instance, this one, and I'll get to this again in a little bit with more details, but this one consists of chemically modified hyaluronic acid, which is a natural component of the extracellular matrix, and gelatin. Gelatin is a hydrolysis product of collagen, so again, another natural component of the extracellular matrix. And so you have these two chemically modified molecules and they're cross-linked with an individual cross-linker. So three different extracellular matrices. In terms of applications, so I told you some of the advantages of moving from 2D to 3D cultures, but for instance, when you're trying to model organs in vitro, obviously having a three-dimensional environment to grow your cells in is more representative than a 2D. In vitro disease models, again, for therapy screening and applications comparable to that would be more relevant in 3D. Personalized therapy and drug screening, where this is a project, for instance, that I worked on when I was in Glenn's lab. We got tumor biopsies for the cancer patients treated at Huntsman Cancer Institute. We would isolate cells, grow them in our matrix, and then test different drugs to see how they affect the tumor cells. And then also, something that's not very intuitive, but when people try to create primary cell banks, right? So you extract cells from a tissue, and again, you want to make sure that now you have enough tissue to distribute to other researchers and all that. But for instance, with many cells, and especially tumor cells, researchers notice that the moment the cells are isolated and plated on 2D, they lose their phenotype. So obviously, there are some drastic changes that undergo at cellular level that have to do with the substrate that the cells are grown in. And so 3D cell cultures would be a big plus there. Now, okay, so there's a need for 3D cell cultures. There's matrices. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is that once you put cells in 3D, it's really hard to get them out, right? So imagine growing cells in Jell-O, which is fine. You have your cells living happily in Jell-O, multiplying and doing what cells do. But now you get to a point where you want to amplify the cultures and proliferate or subculture, right? The same thing you do with 2D cultures. Well, in order to do that, with the available solutions on the market, you need to do enzymatic hydrolysis. So enzymatically degrade the matrices and recover your cells. Well, that's not always a process that goes well with the cells, and sometimes cells get damaged and the cell viability is lost. So in that context, the current unmet need for this specific market is to come up with a 3D cell culture system that's reversible. And obviously, having the reversibility process gives you the advantage of being able to do 3D cell culture expansion. And you see this representation here where, hypothetically, you would have your cells cultured in gels in 96-well plates. When the cells become confluent, you just shake them with the shaker, add some more fresh matrix, and then from one plate, you can create five plates. But again, your cells are staying in a three-dimensional environment. Okay? So this is where our project kind of comes into play. And again, this is the industry thinking, but in terms of a target product profile, so what are we trying to make? We need to come up with a formulation that's reversible, obviously, since it's for cell cultures, and you need to be able to look at your cells microscopically. You want it to be optically clear. You need to have it cell culture compatible. And what that means is it needs to be able to withstand all the manipulation and processing that's typically happening when you do cell cultures, right? Like washes, media changes, all kinds of other stability at 37 degrees Celsius, right? You need to make sure that you don't have a gel that's going to swell all of a sudden when you put cell culture media on it. So all this cell culture compatibilities need to be addressed. And last but not least, system needs to be cytocompatible, so needs to not kill your cells, basically. Okay, so how did we approach this project? And here is where the hacks come into play. So as I mentioned a few slides ago, I am talking about this specific matrix. So this is an extracellular matrix that was developed by Glenn Presswich, so he's my former PhD advisor, and is now commercialized, and it's sold by Sigma as HiStemC. So the components of this system, as I hinted earlier, is gelatin. And again, gelatin is the hydrolysis product of collagen. So it's something that the body and cells recognize as familiar. And consists of hyaluronic acid. They're chemically modified, which I'm not showing the chemical modifications here. And they're cross-linked with the polyethylene glycol diacrylate cross-linker. So basically, how the process goes is you would put your cells in this solution of gelatin and HA. You would add in the crosslinker, mix it or vortex it even if you shake it. And it can stay as a liquid for, I would say, probably 15 seconds or so. And then it gels to a goop. So that's your gel, right? And then that's what provides the cells with the 3D environment. Now, we thought of coming up with our reversible system by taking advantage of the good cell compatibility of hyaluronan and gelatin. So hyaluronan is abbreviated as HA, gelatin abbreviated as G. Therefore, when you cross-link them together, they form HAGs, right? So for our HAG project, what we did here, we activated the gelatin with glycine methyl ester, and then we added to it an amine-containing handle, and then we used a simple EDC chemistry to couple this amine with carboxy groups. And this is basically our HAG. So unlike this system, you don't have two components linked together by a third element, which is the crosslinker, but you have the big macromolecule, which is hyaluronic acid, that has gelatin decorations on it. So first step was, did the reaction work? And so for that, we did a simple NMR. And with macromolecules, you typically don't assign every peak. You just look at the signature. But basically, you can see here that the first one is the HA NMR signal. So these are all proton NMRs. The middle one is the gelatin NMR signal. And then here is our conjugated product that's been purified. And so obviously, you can see the signals corresponding to both HA and gelatin, indicating that the cross-linking reaction was successful. OK, so we have the HAGs, which we want because we want the cells to recognize these elements as something as they know. And so now we want it to form a hydrogel, right? Because that's the purpose, to form a 3D matrix. So how do we form the hydrogel? So when you add in tails, so again, remember, this is the hydrolyzed tails that's activated to polymerize. And you add in the HAGs, which is the HA chain with the gelatin conjugations here. Well, the idea is that you have the tails forming this network, which is basically the scaffold, and then you have the HAG molecules intertwined in that network, okay? So this gel should be reversible because tails gels are reversible, so tails gels are thixotropic. So that's the component that's gonna give us the reversibility of the hydrogel. Now, obviously, we looked at optical clarity and how different ways of making the gels affect the optical clarity. So for instance, if we just mixed HAGs together with tails, and then we added acid to that mix to hydrolyze tails, we ended up with gels, but this is how they look. So this is not something you want to grow your cells in. Now we tried then to pre-hydrolyze tails, so have a separate vial where we pre-hydrolyze tails and then just mix the hydrolyze tails with the HAGs, and we ended up having clear gels. And we were like, bingo, okay, this is the recipe, we'll stay with this. Then we wanted to see, okay, well, how does the HAG concentration in the hydrogel affect gel properties? And you see here HAG concentrations increasing from 0 to 3%. So the mixture of HAG to tails was 3 to 5 volume ratios. And you'll see that in a second. But basically, you can see here that whenever we have a low concentration of HAGs, we don't really form gels. And at higher concentration of HAGs, we have stiffer gels. So notice how this gel is kind of concave here, meaning that it's softer. And as we go to higher concentrations of HAGs, we end up with stiffer gels. Now, because we want, again, we want something that's holding up when we do media changes for cells or washes like that, we decided to go with these top formulations. Actually, we tested three. We tested 2%, 2.5%, and 3%. I'm just showing you data here for the two extremes. So TX2 will stand for 2% HAG with 3 to 5 HAG to TEOS ratio. And then TX3 is with 3% HAG. So more gelatin HA. So we wanted to characterize the hydrogels, and we looked at thixotropy, right, because one of our key requirements is to be reversible. And we do show, indeed, that we tested randomly three cycles here. What this graph indicates here, so these blue lines being higher than the green lines indicate that the material behaves like a gel. So the storage modulus is higher than the loss modulus. So what happens here, and this is a typical behavior for thixotropy, but you notice that as you stress the material, it transitions to a liquid, right? Now when we stop the stress for 30 seconds, it goes back to a gel. When we stress it again, it transitions to a liquid. Stop it again, we repeat the cycle. So we see thixotropy. We see that our material can multiple times transition between a gel and solution. And so as a function of the HAG concentrations, we can get G prime values, which is the storage modulus, between 75 and 600 kilopascals. And these are representative of the physiological extracellular matrices. So obviously, softer tissues have softer matrices. Harder tissues, such as bone, have harder one. And so, okay, we're good with the reversibility, but we wanted to see how are we with cell compatibility. So we used tissue culture plate as a control. This is your old, boring 2D tissue culture plate. Then we had cells encapsulated in Arctic gels, so TX2, 2% HAG, 3% HAG, and this is the high stem. So this is the high stem that has basically the same components as ours, except that it's not reversible. So what's important to know here, we're using primary human dermal fibroblasts. So our cells are not immortalized. They're sensitive to material effects, and they're a good indicator of how your cells would behave when implanted in an organism, for instance, right? But take a look at the phenotype, for instance. So panel A is tissue culture plate. And this is what we all learned in school as the traditional phenotypes for fibroblasts, so spindle-like. Then here, in panel B, we have high stem. High stem, you notice that the cells are rounded, but they're distributed three-dimensionally, so I don't know how well you can see it on the screen, but some cells are in focus, some cells are out of focus just because it's 3D. And they're rounded. So it's not something that's representative for your well-known spindle shape behavior. And then we see the same rounded phenotype with our Thixogels. Now here, this data comes from a live dead assay. And what that assay does is basically contains two dyes. One is a dye that goes into dead cells, so cells that have a broken cell membrane, and it binds to the DNA of dead cells, and it starts to fluoresce red. So whenever you see red dots, that means you have dead cells. The other dye is a calcein dye that goes through the cell membranes, and it's reduced by the cellular esterases to form this green fluorescent dyes. So basically, that's why it's called a live dead, because green cells are live, red cells are dead. So what we see here, actually, is that our cells seems to be live. We don't really have a lot of dead cells. However, that's not a complete characterization of cell behavior in these matrices. So what else do we need to know besides the fact that they're live or dead? Are they metabolically active? And so for that, we have what's called an MTS assay. So it's another colorimetric assay where you add a yellow solution to the cells. And if your cells are metabolically active, they're going to reduce the dye and form a red-orangish product. And that's the color intensity is proportional with the cell's metabolic activity. So the higher the MTS read, the more active your cells are. Now, this example here, so this chart here is showing the results of the MTS assay. So this is the level of activity on tissue culture plates. This is the level of activity on high stem. and it's lower in ours, okay? So at this point, these results are telling us that our materials don't seem to be killing cells because we have the live dead indicator that's telling us so. But then our MTS results are telling us that cells in our matrices are not as metabolically active as they are in high stem or on tissue culture plate. So that's something to further investigate. But however, in terms of the target product profile, we did show that our Thixogels can be reversible, are optically clear, can be used for cell cultures, right? We ran cell cultures with it, and seems to be cytocompatible. So we pretty much checked the boxes, and in terms of cytocompatibility, I think the data we have so far is good enough as a proof of concept for this project. And further on, we'll need to investigate what do the matrices do to the cell's metabolic activity. Figure out how they interact with stem cells versus primary cells, and where can we take this application. Okay, so moving on to how we became all ears. So I had this Thixogel in the lab, right? So I have a cool material that transitions between gel and liquid. And so my product development scientist hat was like, okay, what can you use it for? And we adopted a dog last October, and the dog needed eardrops. And my dog is a very nice dog, but putting eardrops in his ears twice a day for 10 days, it's not the most favorable part of the day for me. So I was like, can we use our Thixogels for eardrops and develop them into eardrops? So the All Ears project is focused on thixotropic gel development for orthic therapeutics. And so obviously, there was the beginning of the idea, let's make eardrops for dogs. But I was like, okay, we need to understand a little bit more about what conditions happen in humans and animals, and how can we tailor our product for those needs. So human ear, quick anatomy lesson. So the human ear consists of the outer part that has the pinna and the auditory canal, and it ends in the eardrum or tympanic membrane. Then it has the middle ear that contains the ossicles, so it's the three little bones that help propagate the sound. And then it contains the inner ear, which is responsible primarily for balance and head position. So, okay, the thing is that in dogs, the ear canal, well, the anatomy overall is pretty similar. However, the ear canal has this L shape. So I was like, okay, maybe there's an opportunity there. It's harder to get something in through an L-shaped ear canal than it is for humans. And, you know, I mean, in humans, if you have an ear infection, you're like, okay, let's just do the drops and it's gonna be okay. But I was like, okay, maybe for dogs we can develop something here. Well, it turns out that you can do a therapeutic solution that would be suitable for both species. So ear infections, let's take a look at them. So the most common ones are otitis externa, or OE, and otitis media. Now, otitis externa is 98% of bacterial origin, and the predominant strains that cause otitis externa are Pseudomonas aeruginosa and S. aureus. Now, the treatment typically involves topical applications of antibiotic solutions. Sometimes the doctors recommend like a 2% acetic acid solution to change the pH of the local environment. But the treatment involves multiple applications, and a typical regime is 7 to 10 days. Now, studies came out and showed that approximately 40% of the patients are not doing the treatment correctly, and they tend to under-medicate, and especially when they have to self-apply the medicine, that's when issues happen. If you have mom treating the child, it's more likely to be efficient. The other thing that's interesting, the otitis externa is most common in dogs. So dogs, when they get ear infections, most of the time it's OE. Now, when we look at otitis media, it's also predominantly bacterial in origin. The strains are different than for otitis externa. And in this case, because now you have the tympanic membrane barrier, so it's not that easy to treat it topically, the treatment includes systemic administration of antibiotics. So it's oral pills. And sometimes, so there's some new therapies coming out, which I don't know how patient-friendly are. There's ways to do intratympanic injections of different therapeutics into the middle ear and treat it that way. Now, this is the most common form in humans. So I don't know how many of you had kids that just started daycare, but when my kids started daycare for the first year, almost every other month they had ear infections, which is not fun to deal with. But OM affects primarily kids. Otitis externa, even though it's less common in humans than otitis than in dogs, it's also known as swimmer ears. So there's a lot of people getting swimmer ears too. And in that case, it affects children, adolescents, and adults. So there's a large demographic that you could cater to with a single application, one-time administration ophthalmic product that you would apply once and it would slow release antibiotics. So this is where our current unmet need was. So what if we can develop a therapeutic that you could package as a one-dose application syringe? You just tell the patient, hey, squirt everything in your ear, and you're going to be good. You don't have to do anything else. And so obviously, especially with dogs and cats, where it's more of an issue to apply drops, people started compounding antibiotic solutions with wax-like materials. One example that you see often is lanolin. So lanolin is an animal-derived wax. And so they use lanolin to mix it in with the antibiotic and apply it into dogs' and cats' ears for slow release of the medicine. So that would be a one, maybe two-time application versus twice a day for 14 days or something. But a lot of dog owners complain that their dog loses hearing. Well, it kind of makes sense. You put a big blob of wax in your ear, you know, so it's kind of not the easiest thing. The other thing that's also a challenge, it's a wax, right? So at room temperature or at cold temperatures, it's hard, solid. And so in order to put it into the dog's ear, you will need to heat it up. So people try to heat it up to around 40 degrees Celsius. Sometimes it gets hotter. And obviously, the patients are not happy. So anyway, we feel like there's a good opportunity for us to come up with something better. And along those lines, we target to develop a product that has easy application, so something that's easy to deploy. Needs to have antibacterial properties, because I just showed you that both OM and OE have bacterial origins. OE, again, if you remember, it's two specific strains, Pseudomonas aeruginosa and S. aureus. It needs to be stable at room temperature at least and at 37. Why at 37? Because that's the temperature in our ear. And obviously, if you want to make a product that's going to be successful, it needs to be patient-centered, meaning that patients need to feel like it's something that they really can easily apply and it works well for them. Needs to be cost-efficient when you're talking about manufacturability and scalability. And ideally, you would want it to have a rapid regulatory approval. So veterinary products are not very stringently regulated by FDA. And then medical devices, depending on which class they fall in, have an easier or a more convoluted path to get to the market. So these are all the boxes that we're trying to check with our project. Again, going back to our foundational material, the thixotropic hydrogels. So we already have something that's a gel that you can shake and turn into liquid. And so in theory, you can imagine if you pack it in a dropping bottle or just a syringe, a patient could easily apply it. So I think we have the easy application part checked. Again, we made three different formulations here. Now in this case, we don't have any other components. It's just hydrolyzed teos and water, right? So we have a low density teos, which is TXL. I have a medium density teos, which is TXM, and then a high density teos. So the more teos you have, the stiffer the gel, okay? And you can see here with this upside down tube that all of them form nice gels. And again, this is the polymerization reaction. So this is the teos undergoing acid hydrolysis, going through a short-lived silicate to form the polymerized network. So we wanted to make sure that in this case, we're monitoring the hydrolysis process. And so the good thing during this process is that the reaction byproduct is ethanol. So basically, you can monitor the efficiency of hydrolysis by following the formation of ethanol in your reaction mix. And we monitor this by FTIR. So this is the signature of Theos. This is the signature of just a control ethanol. And then in hydrolyzed Theos, we notice the peaks characteristic to ethanol showing up after hydrolysis. So this confirmed that, yes, we're successfully hydrolyzing our Theos. We looked at the reversibility of the systems, because again, you want something that would be a gel and it's easy to apply as a liquid. All three formulations showed thixotropy over three cycles. The stiffness of the gel obviously increases with the amount of Theos that you have in there. One thing that you notice here, though, is that the initial peaks here are lower than the following peaks. And what we think is happening is that during testing, so the way we test this, we have a hybrid rheometer dynamic mechanical analyzer, which I call our fancy curry coffee machine because it really looks like that. But it has two, so the fixtures contain two cylindrical parts. The one we use for this one is 8 millimeters. So you put your gel on the 8 millimeter plate, you lower the upper fixture to a specified gap, and then you start stressing your material. And then you stop stressing it for that 30 seconds. Then you start stressing it again. So what we think is happening is you're squeezing out some of the water. And that's why we see the increase in G prime here. That's not an issue whatsoever in the context of current application, but it's just good to understand the data. So obviously, in terms of a product, we wanted to know, okay, if we make a product out of this, is it gonna be suitable with shipping, storing, just application conditions, and just as a regular shelf life understanding, we wanted to see, is it stable over a range of temperature? So we looked at the three materials over 66 degrees. So we started at 4 degrees Celsius, we went up to 70 degrees Celsius, and we noticed that the materials are pretty stable. We noticed a small shift of like 500 pascals, which is in the context of the values that we have, it's less than 10%. When we reach temperatures above 60, where's the mouse? When we reach temperatures above 60. So we think that at that point we have some water evaporation happening, and that's why we see that little upward stem that you can see it nicely here. But again, so those would be extreme temperatures when you think of a product. I mean, maybe if you put it in UPS and drives through Arizona in the summer, it's gonna happen. But again, it's good to understand the limits of our product. Now, the other thing we wanted to look at, okay, so you put it in an animal's ear. An infected ear has a lot of fluid. So what happens with our material when you put it in a fluid-filled environment? And so we looked at the swelling properties. So same rheometer we used. We put the material in between the fixtures, and we lowered the upper fixture to put a constant pressure of 0.1 newtons. So we then added PBS, which is saline, basically. We added PBS to our system, and we followed it throughout 30 minutes. So basically, if the gel would swell, the gap would increase, right? It would push up your fixture. But in our case, we noticed that there was no swelling with these materials. So they maintained the gap nicely, which would indicate that if you put in 100 microliters, it's gonna stay 100 microliters, not gonna fill up. Okay, so we have reversibility, we have temperature stability, we have swelling. Okay, but we're trying to solve or to treat bacterial infections. So we need it to be antibacterial. So we wanted to know if this this material is able to release drugs in a controlled fashion. So as a drug model, we use fluorescein. And the reason why we use fluorescein is because first of all, is fluorescent. So it's really easy to monitor where it is. Is it in a gel or is it coming out of the gel? Second, it's pretty hydrophobic, which is similar to antibiotics commonly used in treating ear infections. And molecular weight-wise, it's pretty similar to gentamicin, for instance, which is commonly prescribed for ear infections. And talk about the data. So you see here the release profile of, so the top square ones are the dense, the TXH. So, So this top line is for the sample that contains the most tails. The middle one is for the sample that contains the intermediary amount of tails. And the bottom one is for the hydrogel that contains the least amount of tails. So we see that the highest amount of tails releases the faster. And we have full release of the drug, which is 100%, by day 7, which is nice because this is something that we want to see. We want to see slow release. And as a control, we use lanolin, which I was told was hard to work with and not to ask them to repeat the experiments too many times because it's really, really hard to work with. Basically, pipettes, everything needs to be pre-warmed to 40 and the material really solidifies when you're trying to transfer from one vial to the other. So anyway, the experiments were done in triplicate and we got this nice release curve or line for lanolin, and you can see that compared to our tails, lanolin releases drugs way slower than our hydrogels, which may not be a good thing in terms of what's the effective dose to kill bacteria, right? So if you load, for instance, 3 micrograms and the efficient dose is 0.5 micrograms, it might take you a long time to release that right amount of medicine. So then we wanted to see, okay, we have slow release, but can we have any control over it? Meaning maybe I want it to release slower or faster. So the thought was here, what happens if we incorporate some large molecular weight polymers that are biocompatible in different percentages and see how they affect the release curve? So we used polyethylene glycol, molecular weight 200, and then here you have polyethylene glycol molecular weight 600, different concentrations. And what you see is, so this is again the TX high, the fastest releasing hydrogel. And what we see that we have a concentration dependent decrease in the release rate by incorporating more PEG. Which is nice because that tells us that, hey, if the doctor is not satisfied with my release rate, I can just make a product with different formulation and have a different release rate. We saw a similar effect with PEG 600. We don't have the 75% formulation here because it formed softer gels that were not easy to work with. And so we also tested PEG 1000. So we bought PEG 2000, PEG 200, 600, and 1000. But whenever we tried to mix in the Thixogels with PEG 1000, they would not gel. It would be too much of an interruption of the TEOS network. So basically, if we compare it here, the PEG 200 50% versus PEG 600 50%, we see that the longer the molecular weight of the polymer, the slower the release rate. So again, this is a good thing to know in case you want to customize your product for different application and control your release rate. We also wanted to know how much drug can we load. So for instance, if my doctor says that they need 3 milligrams per ml to be in the gel, what kind of initial solution do I need to make to make sure that the product in the end has that effective quantity? So we looked at different concentrations here of fluorescein solution from 120 to 200 milligrams per ml, not a wide range. And the loading efficiency was pretty consistent. We were like in the 65 to 75% range. So that's a pretty good loading ratio for these materials. So we next wanted to see, come on computer, there you go. We next wanted to see, okay, we nicely release fluorescein, which we can nicely monitor and we get some nice data, but can we efficiently kill bacteria? So our collaborator from Department of Chemistry, Dr. Nigel Presley, has his lab set up to run antibacterial assays. And I specifically asked for the two bad strains, the aeruginosa and the aureus. And they were like, sure, we have them. And I was like, OK, can you please, please test my hydrogels? And so they got us in. There was some waiting time, but we were basically able to assess our materials. So here what you see is TXL, so again, the low TEOS concentration, loaded with gentamicin at 3 milligram per ml. This is the dose that's currently in the otic drops that you find in stores. And we also wanted to see what happens if we load 10 times less. So we also have PLC with 0.3 milligrams per ml gentamicin. So if we look at the effect of TEOS concentration on the antibacterial effect, we see that both these materials that were loaded with the pharmaceutical dose gentamicin decreased bacterial growth 100%. So they were bacteriostatic. However, at lower concentrations, that's not true. And then the assay endpoints was 5 hours and 24 hours for SRAOs, so 5 hours corresponds to the doubling time of the bacteria. And then for aeruginosa, it was 8 hours and 24. So again, doubling time and 24. And so we see that at lower concentrations, we don't see full inhibition of bacterial growth. In aeruginosa, we saw a similar trend for the 3 milligrams per ml gentamicin, both in the TXL and the TXH formulation. And we saw that not only we didn't inhibit bacterial growth, but this seemed to accelerate bacterial growth here. So again, it seems like that 3 milligram per ml is the amount that we want to go with. We also wanted to see, again, since we looked at the drug release effects of PEG, we wanted to see how the incorporation of PEG affects the antibacterial activity. So you see here for SRAOs, TXH with gentamicin, again, this is the same control as here, inhibiting growth 100%. The controls with PEG promote bacterial growth. Controls with, Thixogels with PEG 200 and gentamicin inhibit growth, and then with PEG 600 is the same trend. So basically this shows that just adding PEG in our materials, it's not gonna diminish the antibacterial activity. And we saw similar effects for aeruginosa. So again, Thixogel with genta, which is this control from here, this one's here. And then just adding PEG 200 when we have gentamicin did not affect the results. So basically, our materials can kill bacteria. And we wanted to see, are they cytocompatible? So what happens when you put it in a dog's ear or a patient's ear? What happens to the skin? So again, tissue culture plate here and our Thixogels. This is the MTS assay, if you remember, similar to the other project. Those are not metabolically very active here. So I'm like, I don't know what's going on there. But the live dead assay tells me that they're not dead, at least just from the output of the assay. So I wanted to see what happens if you now incorporate PEG into your gels. So surely enough, when we started incorporating PEG 600 at different concentrations, we see an increase in the metabolic activity. And then definitely cell viability was pretty good. However, we see some vacuolation here, which is basically the cytoplasm starts to have these vacuoles. And we believe that comes from TEOS. So TEOS polymerizes going through nanoparticles. And then when cells uptake the nanoparticles, this is typically something that you will see with that. So it's called vacuolation. So at this point, the result is indicating that it appears that we're not cytotoxic in the sense that we're not killing cells. The metabolic activity seems to be subpar to tissue culture plate, but then the question is, what would you want in terms of metabolic activity in these cells? Do you want to be have metabolically active cells, or having dormant cells is a good thing? So down the line, this is something that we can look at. And again, when you're talking about the product or a product, you put it in your ear, what happens with it? Stays with you for 10 years, or what happens? So we wanted to see, okay, what's going to happen with it? So we mimicked the physiological environment, and basically we had this oven set to 37 degrees. It was humidified, so just a moist environment. And we put these tubes open with hydrogels in the oven, and then we monitored their weight throughout 7 days. So our data indicates that our materials would dehydrate, which is the normal and expected way for them to degrade or dissipate, would dehydrate, and within 5 days, basically, they would come down to the dry material. And so you can see here for the Thixogel formulations, the data that's normalized for 100 microgram of gel, 100 microgram of gel would go down in 5 days to 1 microgram. So that would not be an issue. So unlike lanolin that causes hearing loss because it's a blob of wax in someone's ear, this material most likely would not cause the same issues. We don't have any hearing tests performed as of now, but we have a collaborator in Utah that's an ENT surgeon, and he has an animal model where he can test that. So it's going to be something that we're going to look at. Okay. So in terms of target product profile, easy application. I think we have a check for that. It's pretty easy to put it in. Antibacterial, we show that we can kill bacteria. It is biocompatible, but again, we don't fully understand all the implications of our results. We do have stability at 37 and room temperature and over a wide range of temperatures. It is cost efficient because Theos is really cheap. Bag is also cheap, so it would be easy to manufacture and scale. Patient-centered, I would think it is, but I don't have any proof. So we didn't do any user testing, so I don't know how that would go. And most likely, this would be a product with rapid regulatory approval. Again, in terms of a veterinary application, it should go through fairly fast. And then there are already Theos-based products on the market that are FDA approved. So even for human use, just going with a predicate device, like a 510K approval path, that should be pretty easy. So I kind of went through the projects fast in the interest of time. But most of the work presented here was done by Christian and Bobby, which are here. We have to thank Glenn for introducing us to the Thixowatt project. And Priestley Lab, Professor Nigel Priestley and Jeremy Alverson. Jeremy performed all the antibacterial testing. And George is my dog's veterinarian, Dr. Marley Johnston, with whom we had numerous conversations about how excited she would be to have a product like this on the market, and walking us through what's currently available and what are the issues with existing products. And the funding comes from University of Montana Material Sciences new faculty support. And as I promised, I have one last slide, the fun stuff in the Serban lab. So we like to do a lot of outreach. And so here is one of our visits to Hellgate Elementary Schools, where we taught first graders about hydrophobic and hydrophilic materials. Then we have two first grade classes from Hellgate Elementary visiting our lab and doing science experiments. We had three different stations. One was where they made fizzy colored potions. They were very excited to have bubbly stuff that was colored. We looked under the microscope at hair, onion skin, and whatnot. And they learned about the biomaterials that we have in the lab, which is silk, hyaluronic acid, and gelatin. And here is an example of Christian, who went to Rattlesnake Elementary and was teaching, I think they were fourth graders, about elephant toothpaste. So yeah, we're trying to mix business with some fun and kind of spend some time with kids and teaching them science and share our passion for science. So with that, thank you so much for your attention, and please let me know if you have any questions.
Any temperature dependence on the thixotropic properties? Or is it?
So for the HAG-containing materials, we only did, I think it was 20 to 40 degrees, and we see a slight increase. Nothing really significant. And then for the thixogels, that's without any polymers, we don't see any temperature dependence until up to 60. So I think we would be good there.
It's Mark? Kind of silly, but do other pets get ear infections?
Yes, so cats also get ear infections, and so again, the treatment would be good for cats too. Rabbits also get ear infections. Cats and dogs have this L-shaped auditory canal, so I think it's more challenging to apply medicine there because you kind of want to make sure that it gets close to the eardrum. And based on Marley's on our conversations with Marley, rabbits and chinchillas have straight ear canals similar to humans, so those will be easier to apply. I learned a lot about chinchilla ears.
This is rather trivial, but what was the, what, you said some kind of toothpaste, what kind of toothpaste did you say?
Elephant toothpaste.
Elephant.
Don't ask me what it is, because I don't remember. I think it's potassium iodide and something else. And it's pretty cool because it starts foaming, but before it starts foaming, it really has like this, like you would squirt out toothpaste from a toothpaste container. So you see, and he actually has a picture. It's kind of like a squiggly foam that goes up here, and the reaction ends with this foam. So kids love it, but you need to be outdoors somewhere to do that. So, yeah. Yes, Mark.
Can you test it on animals, or you might have said that before I came?
Our product?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, the idea is to move towards preclinical trials, but before that, we can do something better. They're organotypic skin models, meaning they're three-dimensional skin pieces that people grow in vitro. So it's basically like a piece of skin. And then instead of having to come up with an animal protocol and account for that, you can test these materials first on those organotypic models and kind of get a more comprehensive read. You can look at inflammatory molecules and all kinds of other parameters that would help to then move it forward. Or at that point would be good to figure out if you need to optimize it further for biocompatibility. And I think if we're trying to develop this towards the veterinary route, we would want to test it with dog or cat cells too, because yeah, we're pretty similar, but again, the cytocompatibility might be slightly different between species. So that's something else that we need to look at.
That's wild.
So is there any correlation between the stiffness of the gels and like the temperature range that it works with, or is that?
For which product?
The tile gels, when you said that when you were, I don't remember.
Actually.
Between the 3%, when you were getting close to the 3%, you were getting a little stiffer. And is there a relationship between that and?
Yeah, I don't think so. I'm trying to go back to the slide. Let's see if I can get back to the slide. Oh, yeah. Okay, so if you look here, so this is the high, medium, and low. All of them pretty much had the same trend.
Just a little tiny bit right there is all.
Yeah. And so, yeah, the Theos amount did not seem to make a difference. I think that's why I think it's evaporation, because it's probably a constant evaporation rate, and that's why you see the comparable pattern with all of them. Yes.
I remember from when I was a kid and had a dog that was my pal, that whenever I put anything in his ear, he'd shake his head like crazy. And I was wondering whether that would liquefy the gels.
So probably not. So these gels need to be, like the stress needs to be in immediate contact with the gel. You know, so just, I don't know how to best explain it, but if you would have, say, a conical with a gel in an ice bucket, and you would shake the ice bucket, it would not liquefy the gel. You would literally have to shake the tube. Does it make sense? So my assumption is, and again, this would have to be proven with preclinical trials probably, my assumption is that once you apply the material, it's gonna gel in place and it's gonna stay there. It's not gonna come out. So that's another benefit, especially with cats and dogs, they're gonna shake their heads, right? And again, it's going to be a one application where you can just go and let the vet do their job and not have to tackle your dog every other day, twice a day to, you know, treat them. So, and even in humans, I mean, if you can just have something that's one application, I'd rather do that than having to put eardrops in my ears twice a day, right? Not the most pleasant thing. So, I mean, I think the idea is good. Hopefully we can take it further and show that it's going to work in real studies, in clinical studies, in preclinical studies.
And do that L-shaped tube help keep it from coming out?
Right. That would definitely do so. I mean, once it gets down there, it's really hard to, you know, get it out. But again, if it's a liquid, chances are it's going to come out when the dog leaves out.
So you would receive a container of it, and it would be gel. And you shake it vigorously and it turns liquid, and then you put it in the dog's ear and then it would gel up again. But their shaking wouldn't be able to get it back.
Yeah. Yeah, because you have to shake the syringe. So you would shake the syringe. So that's my example with the ice bucket and the tube, right? So if you just shake the whole container, it's not going to liquefy the gel. And then, I mean, if you think about it, you don't even need to liquefy it. You can just squirt it in as a gel and have it stay in place, you know, in a dog. So you might even be able to deploy it without, you know, going through the liquefaction step. So.
Okay.